Thanks for joining me again. It's the 28th of March today, and gosh, it's hard to believe that we're already nearly a quarter of the way through the year. We're in the middle house week of a three-week session this week, and it's going to be a real highlight tomorrow because we're doing the third reading of some treaty settlement bills, and so it will be a really fantastic day for those iwi who are here, and for some of them the settlement process has been over not just months and years, but in some cases decades. So it's going to be a really big day in the House. And we'll be applying the new standing orders that we passed at the end of last year, which basically allows the House to sit when the select committees sit, that allow us to just have a few more hours in the House and progress some of this important legislation. So that'll be tomorrow. Last week was fantastic. Actually had two ministers in the electorate, which was great. One was Phil Heatley. He's the new Minister of Energy and Resources. So he was in the electorate having a look at our geothermal and hydro energy. And of course, presents some really fantastic opportunities for the future. So we went out and had a look at the drilling site and the construction site for the Ngā Tamariki power station, which is the new power station that's underway with Mighty River Power. Then I also had Chris Finlayson, who is the Attorney General, the Associate Minister of Māori Affairs, Minister of Arts, Culture and Heritage, Minister of Treaty Negotiations and the Acting Minister for the Environment. Gosh, that's a bit of a mouthful, isn't it? Imagine his workload. Anyway, so we had the 25th celebration of Raukawa, and it was just, I was there for several hours on Saturday morning, and it was really was a day of celebration. So it was great to be part of it. Great to see how much Raukawa contributes to the community in the South Waikato, and I'm really looking forward to the day that I get to participate in the House with their final reading of their settlement legislation, and I'm sure it's a day that they are equally looking forward to. In terms of other things that are of importance, I mentioned last week that I did want to talk to you a little bit about welfare reform, and Minister Paula Bennett's actually been debating this in the House today. And it's really interesting. I think the thing that I find quite staggering is that the opposition actually haven't had much to say about it. And I think the reason for that is that there is a general level of public acceptance for the fact that we do have to make some major changes in welfare. So one of the areas in particular I wanted to talk about today is just to set the record straight in some of the areas, particularly around sole parents and the work tests that have been included. So you may be aware that at the moment there's a requirement for someone who's a sole parent when their youngest child is 18 to return to work. So we're reducing that to 14, which I think makes a whole lot of sense. The other change that we've made around the work testing is the requirement for people to make themselves available for part-time work. Previously that had been when the youngest was age 6, and we're moving that to 5. Again, makes a bit of sense. Usually your children are at school by that stage, so it's making people available for work at that stage. The one that has been widely misreported, which I find incredibly frustrating, is that around subsequent children. So we have around 4,000 children each year born into a family of someone who is already dependent on the state for the domestic purposes benefit. And this is what we call subsequent children. And what we have said is when that subsequent child reaches the age of 12 months, then there is a requirement for that parent to make themselves available for work. And so it doesn't apply for all, it's just for those subsequent children, of which there are approximately 4,000. Now, one of the reasons that the welfare reform is so important is that we've seen in the previous decade a situation where numbers in effect transferred from the unemployment benefit onto the sickness and invalids benefits. And one of the things that is concerning when someone's put on an invalids benefit is in effect they sit there and they're written off. And that doesn't provide any opportunity for them and their family to get out of that welfare trap, to get out of a life of poverty and to have a life of new opportunities. So it's been interesting that the number on the invalids benefit rose approximately 40% under Labor's time, and under our watch, it's 0.3%. So we've managed to get that area under control, which is really important. And if you think about the wider picture of welfare reform, it is recognising that a life on welfare is a life of poverty, a life where people don't have opportunities, and really the children often are the ones that suffer the most in those households. So I'm really proud about the work that we are undertaking. The legislation has had its first reading in the House, and it'll go off to Select Committee for the public to have their view. So if it's something that's important to you, I'd really encourage you to make a submission in this process. Friday this week, complete change of subject, I'm going to be in Putaruru at Putaruru College and judging the business awards that the students participate in. Now this is a brilliant program. I've watched a couple of them already, and it's really looking at the fantastic ideas of our young people. They get to, in effect, test it over a number of hours and sell their proposal. It's a bit like Dragon's Den, really, for high school kids. So it's going to be a great way to spend Friday, and I'm looking forward to it. Catch up with you next week.